can be a painful time for some. We come seeking the space and time to acknowledge our sadness. We come together and know we are not alone. We come to receive encouragement to live the days ahead of us. Peace to you, and may the abiding love of God be with you all.
And also with you.
There are times when life is good and beautiful, but there are also times of distress and loss. During those times, we sing sad songs of lament, protest, and complain about the chaos and harshness that life can sometimes be for us. We often feel afraid, angry, and ashamed. Putting words to this experience can often be difficult, especially when the world around us is making merry. So let us do this together. Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Lighten my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death. Lest my enemies say, I have prevailed over him. Lest my foes rejoice because I am shaken.
We come to you, O Lord, seeking answers to our questions. We come to you, O God, because you are the Creator.
But I have trusted your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me.
We come looking for a song to sing. We wait for your voice to call us from beyond our pain.
People, we await your coming. God's promise from the 9th chapter of the prophet Isaiah. The time is coming when there will be no more darkness for those who are in trouble. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. For those living in the land of deep shadows, a light has dawned. The abuse of the oppressor and the cruelty of tyrants will be gone, all with their whips and cudgels and curses, done away with a sudden and surprising deliverance. The boots of all the invading troops, along with their shirts soaked in innocent blood, will be piled up in a heap and burned, a fire that will burn for days. For a child has been born, for us, the gift of a son, for us. He will take over the running of the world. His name will be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His rule and authority will grow and grow, and there will be no limits to the wholeness he brings. God promises he will do this.
When the world was dark and the city was quiet, you came. You crept in beside us, and no one knew, only the few who dared to believe that God might do something different. Will you do the same this Christmas, Lord? Will you come into the darkness of today's world, not the friendly darkness, as when sleep... When the world was dark and the city was quiet, you came. You crept in beside us and no one knew, only the few who dared to believe that God might do something different. Will you do the same this Christmas, Lord? Will you come into the darkness of today's world, not the friendly darkness, as when sleep recuses us from tiredness, but the fearful darkness in which people have stopped believing that war will end, or that food will come, or that a government will change, or that the church cares. Will you come into that darkness and do something different to save your people from death and despair? Will you come into the quietness of this community, not the friendly quietness as when lovers hold hands, but the fearful silence when the phone is not rung, the letter has not come, the friendly voice no longer speaks, the doctor's face says it all. Will you come into the darkness and do something different? Not to distract, but to embrace your people. Will you come into the darkness, dark corners, and the quiet places of our lives? We ask not because we are guilt-ridden, or want to be, but because fullness of our lives long for depends on us being open and vulnerable to you, as you were to us when you came, wearing no more than diapers and trusting human hands to hold their maker. Will you come into our lives if we open them to you and do something different? When the world was dark and the city was quiet, you came. You crept in beside us. To do the same this Christmas, Lord. Do the same this Christmas. Amen.
The King of Kings by Susan Hill. Mr. Hegarty hadn't always been alone, and being alone didn't always mean being lonely, but quite often it did. Once there had been a Mrs. Hegarty, whose name had been Doll, or sometimes Dolly, and they had been married for a great many years, and there had been good days and bad days, but mostly good. Some ups and downs, but mostly ups. And the great many years had not seemed nearly enough before Mrs. Hegarty got ill, and then very much iller, and died. so that now there was only Mr. Hegarty and Cat the Cat and Jacko. Cat the Cat had never been bought or in any other way chosen. He had just come, one day onto the wall, the next day in the yard, the third day into the house, and after that, Mr. Hegarty said, "Pause under the table for good." Cat, like all cats, came and went as he pleased, but Jacko had been chosen all right for his black patch eye and his brave, bright bark, and for being cheap from the man with the cart in the lane, because his legs were bandy. Mr. Hegarty's house was the last in the street. After it came the wharves and the warehouses, the empty lot and the church, the building site, the road and the railway. But walk another way and there were still a few streets left, though not the street where Mr. Hegarty was born and grew to be a man, nor the one where Mrs. Hegarty had been born and got married from all those years ago. They are gone, and their neighbors' houses too, and the pub, and the shop on the corner, pulled down in heaps of dust and rubble and carted away on trucks. There were cranes now, and site offices, concrete girders and craters in the ground, men in hard hats and machines, jutter, jutter, all day, all day. But walk a bit further still, which Mr. Hegarty and Jacko always did, and there was the lane, just as it had always been, and the streets and squares around it, and shops and buses and flats and people, schools and churches, the bit of a park, and the King's Hospital. And now it was Christmas Eve. Mr. Hegarty had been about all day. He liked to be about. He liked Christmas Eve. Everybody talked to everybody else, and there was a lot of bustle. People were cheerful. He'd been about the market among the stalls and carts, and then he and Jacko had stood for a long time on the corner just for the pleasure of watching everything. He'd had his dinner out, pie and chips, and his tea with a mince pie on the house. Lotta, who kept the cafe, had said, "Because it's Christmas." But now it was late, dark. Now everything was closing down. They were sweeping up around the carts, sprigs of holly and paper from the oranges and a few lost Brussels sprouts. "Good night, then. Happy Christmas." Lamps out, blinds up, shutters down. The main road was jammed. The trains went along the line, full of everyone going home. So Mr. Hegarty and Jacko went home, too, across the building site. Quiet now, the great crane still and silent. It had a Christmas tree balanced on the very end with lights and decorations, but the men had finished at dinner time today. Past the warehouses and wharves. Once Mr. Hegarty had been a watchman there, on the wharf. That was when the ships had docked, years ago. There were no ships now. Across the last bit of the empty lot, Jacko's ears twitched. Home. Christmas Eve. The wind blew down the alleys, across the dark wharves, smelling of rain and river. No snow, no star, but Christmas Eve isn't often like the stories. Mr. Hegarty reached home. There was a carrier bag on the step with three wrapped up presents inside and a card. "To Mr. Hegarty and Jacko and Cat, a happy Christmas with love from Joe." Joe and his family lived next door, but they had gone away that morning to stay with his grandmother for the holiday. One day they'd go away all together. Everybody would. This was the last street. Mr. Hegarty didn't want to think about it. Nothing inside the house had changed very much since he and Mrs. Hegarty moved in, newly married, and since Mrs. Hegarty died, nothing had changed at all. Mr. Hegarty wanted it like that, just as it was and had always been, and as she had left it. He kept it clean and put things away in the same old places, and polished the windows and blackened the hearth and washed up in the stone sink and slept in the big brass bed. And every Christmas, he put up the decorations, around the pictures and over the mirror and along the mantelpiece, with a wreath of holly on the front door. just as Mrs. Hegarty always had. It was very quiet. Mr. Hegarty went into the scullery to wash his hands, then fed Jacko and Cat, put the kettle on and made up the fire and sat beside it. And Mrs. Hegarty sat beside him, smiling out from the silver photograph frame on the little table. Later, the band came and played Silent Night and Hark the Herald Angels under the orange lamp at the end of the street, and the man with the collecting tin came down to Mr. Hegarty's door, and they had a chat. Then they played one more carol, which was In the Bleak Midwinter, because it had been Mrs. Hegarty's favorite, before they went away. But for quite a while, the strains of trumpet and tuba and cornet, O Little Town of Bethlehem, and While Shepherds Watched, floated faintly back to him across the wharves and the empty lot, and then it was quiet again. For the rest of the evening, while Jacko and Cat slept on the hearthrug, Mr. Hegarty sat in his armchair thinking, as people do, of other Christmases, good and bad and in between, but mostly good, for times past were golden in the memory of an old and lonely man. At 10 o'clock he got up and Jacko ran to the front door, and they went for their last walk, up the street and down again. There was nobody about, though some of the houses had lights on, glowing behind curtains, and two of them had Christmas trees in the windows. And the wind still blew down the alleyways and across the wharves and the empty lot, with the smell of the river on its breath. Christmas Eve. Mr. Hegarty's heart lifted. It was still special. After all, there was no getting away from that. Then he let Cat out, locked up, wound his watch, and went upstairs to bed. Sometime after midnight, he woke again. At first, he didn't know why. There was no sound, except for Jacko snoring softly. Then there was something, a very faint, distant sound, not inside the house, out. Mr. Hegarty put on his slippers, went downstairs, and opened the front door. Everything was still. It had stopped raining and the wind had died down. The moon shone. Jacko came pattering down the stairs and stopped beside Mr. Hegarty at the front door. There it was again, very faint, a mewling sound. Kittens? Mr. Hegarty put on his coat and shoes and took the flashlight. Then he went out of the house and across the empty lot toward the church. Jacko ran ahead, ears cocked, tail up. There were railings around the old church, but the padlock on the gate was broken. The sound was louder. Mr. Hegarty stopped. The moon came out again from behind a cloud. Jacko had trotted up the weed-covered path to the church porch, and Mr. Hegarty could see him standing beside something, wagging his tail. So he went too. Here, the sound was loud and clear and unmistakable. Mr. Hegarty shone his flashlight. On a ledge, inside the dark, damp, cold stone porch of the church, stood a shallow, cardboard box. Inside the box lay a baby. It was very small and wrapped in a scruffy piece of blanket. "Now then," said Mr. Hegarty softly, "now then." But then he didn't know quite what to do. He and Mrs. Hegarty had never had any children. Mr. Hegarty had never even held a baby. In his own home, there had been seven children, but as he had been the youngest, all the others had picked him up. The moon went behind a cloud again, and the baby stopped crying and just lay. Jacko sat waiting. "Well," said Mr. Hegarty. And then, because there was nothing else that he could do, he picked up the box with the baby in it very gently. And as he did so, he remembered that it was not Christmas Eve any longer, but Christmas Day. Then, carrying the box very carefully, he made his way slowly out of the church porch and back across the empty lot, Jacko trotting at his heels. He couldn't hold the flashlight so well, so he put it in the bottom of the box by the baby's feet. Up the street, past the building site and the wharves and the warehouses, empty and silent, toward the streets and then the market, the shops, the lane, his footsteps echoed. The pubs and cafes had long since shut. The last trains had gone, and there were no cars on the main road. Mr. Hegarty walked on, stopping now and then to set the box down and rest his arms. Then Jacko stopped too and waited patiently. The baby had gone to sleep. From across the last square, beside the bit of park, Mr. Hegarty could see the lights shining out. "Now then," he said. But then, just for a minute, he didn't want to go on, didn't want to let the baby go. He felt a strange, half-sad, half-angry feeling, like a knot tightening inside him. Whoever could have left it in a box, in a cold porch, at Christmas? He looked down at it again. But then, because he knew there was only one right thing to do, he crossed the road and walked up the drive to the entrance. "Stay," he said. Jacko stayed. Then Mr. Hegarty went through the glass doors into the lighted entrance of the King's Hospital. In the hall, there was a huge Christmas tree and paper chains and decorations strung from the ceiling and all around the walls. At the far end was a reception desk with a porter behind it and a nurse standing beside. Mr. Hegarty went up to them and stood holding the box in his arms. "I've brought a baby," he said. In the next hour or so, a lot of things happened. The baby was taken away, and Mr. Hegarty asked to sit down and answer a great many questions from a nurse and a doctor, and finally from two policemen. They brought him a cup of tea, and then another, with a pink bun, and asked him to sign some papers, and the whole time Jacko sat without moving or barking on the step beyond the glass doors. But in the end, the nurse came back again and said, "You can go now, Mr. Hegarty. You must be tired out." "Right," said the policeman. "We'll drop you off. Trafalgar Street, isn't it?" Mr. Hegarty stood up. He was tired, tired enough to drop, and muddled, and in a way, sad. "No, thank you very much," he said. "If it's all the same to you, I'll walk." And he went slowly across the blue carpet to the glass doors where Jacko was waiting. "Come on then," Mr. Hegarty said. Jacko came. He did sleep, just a bit, but it was a strange, restless sleep, full of odd dreams and noises. When he woke properly, it was just coming light, gray, damp looking. "Happy Christmas, Jacko," Mr. Hegarty said. Jacko hardly stirred. He was going to make a pot of tea and then open his present from Joe, but as he washed, he knew that he wouldn't, not yet. Knew that he would have to go there first, straight away, because the baby had been on his mind all night, and he couldn't settle until he'd made sure about it. He let Cat in, whistled to Jacko, and crossed the street all over again in the same direction as before. And as he walked, he wondered, whose baby? When? How? Why? What would happen to it now? He hadn't even found out what it was, a girl or a boy. Hadn't liked to ask. The hospital looked different in the early morning light, larger, grayer, somehow less friendly. But he left Jacko on the step again and went in down the blue carpet. After he'd explained, they left him sitting on a chair in a corridor. The hospital was still quiet, but not like the night before. He could hear doors banging and the elevator going up and down. Perhaps they would bring him a cup of tea again. He always had one as soon as he got up. He was missing it now. But it didn't really matter. He'd had to come. "Mr. Hegarty?" Mr. Hegarty stood up. "Would you like to come with me?" Through the doors, down a corridor. "I'm sure you'd like to see him, wouldn't you?" "Him? A boy then?" "Yes, that is how it should be. He's fine, thanks to you, but if you hadn't found him..." They went down some more corridors, around corners, through doors, and stopped. "You'll see that we've done something special," she said. "We always wait for the first baby born in the hospital on Christmas Day, but there hadn't been one yet. And besides, we thought that your baby was the most important one here today. Come in and see." There were babies in small cribs. Through a glass window, he could see beds. "Look, Mr. Hegarty." At the end of the room, on a small raised platform, stood a crib, draped and decorated under a canopy. Hanging above the canopy was a star. "The Christmas crib," she said, "only used once a year, today. Mr. Hegarty went a step closer, looked down, and there he was. The baby from the cardboard box in the dark church porch. The baby he had found and carried here with Jacko. The Christmas baby. For a while, Mr. Hegarty didn't speak. Then he said quietly, King of Kings, that's who he is. The King of Kings. And went smiling out of the nursery. They did find him a cup of tea, and a breakfast too, and a plate of sausages for Jacko, and said they would be letting him know what happened to the baby when there was any news. And you'll be welcome to come and see him, you know, the nurse said, any day. Thank you, Mr. Hegarty said. Thank you very much. I should like that. And then he went home, with Jacko trotting beside him, through the quiet, early streets of Christmas morning. God of mercy, hear our prayer in this Advent season for ourselves and for our families who live with painful thoughts and memories. We ask for strength for today, courage for tomorrow, and peace for the past. We ask these things in the name of your Christ, who shares our life in joy and sorrow, death and new birth, despair and promise. Amen. This first candle we light to remember those persons whom we have loved and lost. We pause to remember their name, their voice, their face, the memory that binds them to us in this season. We hold them before God, giving thanks for their lives in ours. Please take a moment to remember those who have died. I invite you to name them aloud or in the silence of your heart. Lord, each of us takes our loved ones by the hand and leads them to you, the God of love. Here we present them to you. Accept our love and thanksgiving as we entrust them to your loving care. We want our loved ones to be free at home with you. We ask that you save a place for us beside them. We ask that you fill us with motivation and energy in the days ahead when we feel like giving up. Remind us often of our true homeland when we are caught up in the desolation of the journey. Help us to find joy in the people, events, and the beauty of nature that surrounds us. Thank you for the gift each of these people has been in our lives. We believe that we will celebrate the treasure of love with them again when we are all in your presence forever. May this truth sustain us in the days to come. Take our sad and aching hearts and comfort us. Comfort us, for we only feel hollowness and emptiness. God of sorrowing, draw near. Amen. This second candle we light is to redeem the pain of loss, the loss of relationships, the loss of jobs with the security they bring, the loss of health in ourselves or in family members, the loss of joy and peace in our lives from the stresses which surround us, the loss and loneliness we experience when our loved ones do not share our faith. As we gather up the pain of the past, we offer it to you, O God, asking that into our open hands you will place the gift of peace. Please take a moment to remember the losses. I invite you to name them aloud or in the silence of your hearts. God of mystery, we turn our hearts to you. We come before you in need of peace, grateful for the mystery of life and ever keenly aware of your promises of guidance and protection. We want to place our trust in you, but our hearts grow fearful and anxious. We forget so easily that you will be with us in all that we experience. Teach us to be patient with the transformation of our lives, and to be open to the changes that we are now going through. Amen. The third candle we light is for those who experience a loss of direction in their lives. God of the Exodus, you led Moses and your people through the wilderness to a new land. Hear our prayer. We want so much to have a sense of direction, to know where we are and where we ought to be headed. But the darkness and the questions stay. You ask us to be full of faith, to believe deep within that you are our signpost, that you are our wisdom and our guide, and to trust in your presence. Your words to us are clear. Do not fear. I go before you. Please take a moment to contemplate the changing directions in your own life. God of our depths, we cry out to you to be our guide. Help us to have a strong sense of inner direction and grant that we may have the reassurance of knowing that we are on the right path. Take our lives and use them according to your will. Take all that is lost in us and bring it home to you. Amen. This fourth candle we light as a sign of hope. the hope that the Christmas story offers to us. We remember that God, who shares our life, promises us a place and time of no more pain and suffering. Please take a moment to contemplate the hope that the Incarnation offers us. O God, whose spirit is known by those whose hearts are thankful, and who makes cheerfulness a companion of strength, lift up our hearts, we pray, to a joyous confidence in your care. Guide us when we cannot see the way. Teach us to know that a shadow is only a shadow, because the light of eternal goodness shines behind the object of our fears. Where there is love in life, teach us to find it. Help us to trust it, and enable us to grow in the power of love. So may our lives bring comfort and encouragement to others. We ask these things in the name of Christ, whose life is our light. Amen. The white candle will remain unlit as a sign of waiting for a future that is yet unknown to us, but a future from which God beckons us. Loving God, be for us now a light to brighten our darkness, strength to transform our weakness, and comfort in the midst of our pain. Let us remember the one who shows the way, who brings the truth, and who bears the light. Amen. Each of us comes bearing our own hurts, sorrows, broken places. We have been assured of the power of God that seeks to touch and heal us, but often we cling to our pain as if it were all we have, despite assurances of the saving help of God. I want to invite each of you to offer your personal wound to the God who loves you deeply and wants to carry your pain. I do this in the knowledge that God can only carry us if we consent. Our God is a gentle God, who will never abuse us by taking what we are unwilling to offer. God waits patiently, gently, calling out to us, "Give me your pain. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you." I invite you now to spend a few moments in quiet reflection before God, and to honestly embrace the feelings that are uniquely your own. Some pain you may be unable or unwilling to release. God honors that need and continues to walk with you in your pain. Other pain you may be ready to release. Decide what pain you no longer want to carry on your own, that you are ready to let God carry. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, may our Lord Jesus Christ sustain you with his presence. Drive away all sickness of body, mind, and spirit, and give you that victory of life and that peace which will enable you to serve him both now and evermore. Amen.
Psalm 121. I will lift up mine eyes to the hills. From where is my help to come? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved, and he who watches over you will not fall asleep. Behold,
He who keeps watch over Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord himself watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand, so that the sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. It is he who shall keep you safe. The Lord shall watch over your going out and your coming in from this time forth forevermore.
Jesus said, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you, not the kind of peace the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Now may this peace settle on you, and may God grant you wisdom, courage, and strength for the days ahead. Amen.